Okay, folks, video is on. My uncle's funeral was on Friday and stuff, so I just kind of was like, so if I do not get to that tomorrow, I will just not put that on the exam. Deal?
That's
good. Okay, all right. So I feel like, I don't know, this has just been a very strange semester with a chain of events that, yeah, for all of us, right?
Yes.
Ladies, hurry up. It's like, oh no, mom. Like, trying to be patient. Because if it was my daughter, she would know exactly. But my son, I don't know. So, anyways, I will keep you guys updated on that. And whatever we don't go over will not be on the final exam. One of our friends in class brought up the fact that I've got your exam on Monday the 8th, but the 8th is Wednesday. It's definitely on whatever that Monday is. Okay, so if it's the 6th, it's the 6th, I'll check on it, and I will definitely update you guys so we're clear, because my purpose in life is to not confuse you folks, okay? So I really appreciate whenever you guys email me and tell me there's something confusing or there's a mistake. I really appreciate that, because then it helps the rest of the students, okay? All right, so carbohydrates, friends. Let's talk about these, because these are super exciting. They're like our favorite things ever. So, yes, carbohydrates. So this is a very large group of molecules. And please excuse the formatting error when I put this on Google Slides. Or Doc, sometimes it kind of messes it up and I forget to directly get it off of a PowerPoint file. So all of our carbohydrates, folks, the things we think of when we think of carbohydrates, and also the simple sugars, like glucose and fructose and sucrose, the things that taste sweet. Now, why are they called carbohydrates? Well, right here it says they fit the molecular formula for a hydrate of a carbon in this certain pattern. So we have a certain number of carbons, so that N, that subscript of N, it isn't anything magical, it just means some number. And then you have a certain number, the M right there, as in Mikey, of H2O, okay? So that's kind of the general pattern that we see. Like glucose is C6H12O6, and if we separate out the carbon, we would have C6 and then 6 waters, okay? So it's just kind of
general pattern there. Now,
why is this really important for us? Well, because this is the form of energy that our cells take up. So glucose is really important. That's a sugar, and that's a carbohydrate. So most of the time when we talk about glucose in this country, we're talking about which disease?
Diabetes,
or however you guys want to say it, okay? yes, because it has to do with glucose and insulin and whatnot. So yeah, that's the way that our cells are taking in energy there. So what happens is plants, they take in carbon dioxide and water and energy from the sun, and they do photosynthesis, and out comes some oxygen, which is really nice because we like to breathe in oxygen, and glucose also. And that's good too because we like to eat that. Nom, 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 nom. So sometimes it's just like free glucose, and then sometimes it's glucose, 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 all attached to each other. And in lab, we learned that that's called what? When it's stored in our favorite energy storage device called the potato, that form of carbohydrate, when it's glucose, 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 all in a chain, is called what? Do you guys remember? Starch, yes. Yum, we love starch, okay? So is this kind of sort of all right for everybody? Okay, so this right here, what does that look like if I draw it all out? So plants do the photosynthesis and we do the respiration. Well, what we have is a plant. So I'll draw a tree, kindergarten style. There we go. And what does the tree do? Well, it's like, give me some sun, and here's the sun in the corner. You know, my elementary school. So we've got light energy that comes into the tree, and then the tree is gonna give off like what we saw in the last slide. We got some glucose and some oxygen. And that's gonna go to us down here. And we're like, hi. I'll go to the other hand right there. Whenever I miss something, my students are always sure to tell me, why does that person only have four fingers? I don't know. Because this is chemistry class, not art, right? So here we have photosynthesis. And we do respiration. Okay, so when we do a respiration, what comes out? Yeah, we got CO2. What else? What else do we breathe out with our CO2? Yeah, water. We have water vapor in there. Okay, and what else do we get for our respiration, folks? We get energy, and we take that energy and we use it for different things. So we use it to do cellular work, to heat our bodies. We use it for chemical energy, so movement of proteins, molecular transport, synthesis of biomolecules. So everything that we do, we use this energy that we get from respiration. Are we okay with this, folks?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so it's not a nice little circle of life here, and we can all sing the Lion King song while we take a look at this. Okay, so that was the purpose of that blank slide right there. That's just to do a little bit of art, okay? So, does anyone still need this, or can I move on? Okay, alrighty. So the monosaccharides, so we talked about this in lab last week. So these are our simplest carbohydrates, and these don't break down into other carbohydrates. So they are the base unit of our carbohydrates. Some examples are glucose and fructose, and glucose is also called dextrose. So sometimes you might see that on a nutrition label that you've got dextrose. And these are usually colorless and water soluble. And we saw that when we did the They were a clear color. Sometimes glucose can be like a little bit yellowy instead of just plain old clear, but you could definitely see that they were clear and that they're water soluble. Are we okay with those characteristics there? Okey-dokey. So what happens with our sugars is they have open chain and closed chain forms. So glucose only spends 0.25% of its time in the open chain form. And in lab last week, we learned that this is called the Fischer projection. We learned that before in lecture, but we went over it again in lab. And then we said that the closed form is called the Hayward projection, but the Hayward projection that we saw didn't have the ring all like bent up like this right here. It drew it more of a flat version. And what we had was this, like this. And that was our Hayward. And we will see that quite often in Hayward projections. Now, glucose does not like to be in the open chain. It loves to be in the cyclic form. So this one has got 99.75% of the glucose molecules like this. Okay, so the Hayward projection, how it draws it like this, this is really nice because you can see where everything is. But the ring doesn't actually look like that. The ring looks a little bit wonky like this, and I put it together so you could see it. I just didn't have enough of the little white balls to put them all around here, but you can see how it actually is not flat like the Hayward projection has it. And if you try to make it flat, but you can see with the model that the bonds are straining. So what it'll do is it'll bend like this so that the bonds aren't strained. And the red thing right here, this is the oxygen. So this is that oxygen right there. And I didn't put any of these pieces on here. It just shows the bonds going up and down like that. Now, where you don't see something right here, so there's a carbon here and it has 1, 2, 3 single bonds. What else is here that we don't see but we're supposed to know is there? Hydrogen, yes. So often you'll see the Hayward's projection drawn like this with a little line, and on the top would be hydrogen, hydrogen here, and hydrogen here, and here, and here, okay? So if you don't see that, we assume that there's a hydrogen there. So if you see it drawn like that, so you Google something, and one picture you see has hydrogens and the other one doesn't, one of them is not wrong. It's probably just that whoever drew it didn't want to draw the hydrogens in. Okie dokie, smokies. Any questions for me on this one? Okay, all right, moving on. So we want to classify monosaccharides. Well, maybe you don't because it's the end of the semester, but we have to classify monosaccharides, and we can do it by chain link or functional group or both. Now, our monosaccharides, what you'll notice, folks, is that they're either going to be a ketone or an aldehyde. So the aldehyde is up here. You can see that. And you can see the ketone is right there. Do you folks see that? So our functional groups are coming back to haunt us. Now, if you have a sugar that is, has an aldehyde on it, it's called an aldose. And the os ending, O-S-E, means what? It means sugar, like glucose, fructose, sucrose. Does that sound familiar? So aldose is just saying you have an aldehyde-containing sugar. And if you have a ketose, you have a sugar that has which functional group? A ketone. Good. Okay, so your ketose is a sugar that contains a ketone functional group. Are we okay with this, folks?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now, if we're going to classify by chain link, What we have is that a 3-carbon sugar is called a triose, and a 4-carbon sugar is called a tetrose, 5-carbon sugar, pentose, 6-carbon sugar, hexose, etc., etc. What is an 8-carbon sugar going to be called? An octose. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Are we all right with that, folks?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So over here, notice you have the sugar that has the name of threose. Do you guys see that?
Mm-hmm.
So our brains are going to say, oh, that probably has how many carbons?
Mm-hmm.
Right? But look at it. That's mean, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It should be 4-ose, right? Okay, so be aware that sometimes things can fool us. All right, so ribose right here. We've heard of ribose because of what?
Deoxyribonucleic
acid, or in RNA, ribonucleic acid. Yep. And that's what I wanted to point out right there. So sugars are important not only because we like how they taste, but because they're important for life. Because we like our DNA and our RNA. Okay. So what happens when we put the functional group and chain link together? If you want to do that, which you absolutely can, and you should probably practice because that'll show up on a final exam. So if you have an aldehyde, that would be an aldose. If you have an aldehyde with 5 carbons, you put aldo and pent together, and then you have an aldopentose. You can also call this a pentoaldose. So you can exchange the pent and the ald, and the O goes on the first descriptor right there. Okay, so it goes from aldopentose to pentoaldose, and that's the same thing. It's a sugar that has 5 carbons that contain the aldehyde functional group. Are we okay with this, folks? Okay, so if we have a ketone and it's a sugar, that's going to be a ketose, and if we have a 6-carbon sugar, that would be a hexose, and where did I get that? Well, it's right here. Okay, not tricking you, folks. And if we put those together, we would have a ketohexose. And if we want to write the descriptors in the opposite orientation, what would that be called? A hexo what, folks? A hexoketose. Same thing, okay? Okie-dokie, Smokies?
Mm-hmm.
All right. To deoxyribose. So this is really important for DNA. So we have deoxyribonucleic acid and the deoxy. Take a look at right here. That's carbon number 2. So you got the 2 there, and then you have the D. So deoxy meaning you don't have an oxygen on that carbon right there. Do you folks see that? Okay, so that's why we have the deoxy rather than just like a regular ribose. All right, friends? Okay. So let's do some problems. Because we all love problems, right? Yeah, especially life problems. Just kidding. Okay, so classify the following monosaccharides by both the number of carbons and the functional group. Okay, so this one right here, does it have an aldehyde or a ketone? What's that right there? That's an aldehyde. Remember, the ketone, the carbonyl carbon that's right there, has to be bonded to 2 carbons, a carbon on either side to be. So that one's an aldehyde. Do you guys see that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So that would make this an aldose, right, friends? How many carbons does it have? 3. And what's that called?
with the name of that dumb molecule right there that has four carbons. So a triose is a three carbon sugar. So if we were to put those together, what could we call that? Aldo triose, or a what?
Trioaldose.
Yep. Usually we do this one, but you can do either way. Not too bad, folks? Okay, good. And the next one is hard for me to say, erythrulose. Is that a ketone or is that an aldehyde? Ketone, and it's a sugar, so that's a what? A ketose, yeah. So the O's ending, friends, O-S-E means sugar. What about if you had an A-S-E-N ending? Like sucrose would be the sugar, but sucrase is a what? Substrate is. So sucrose being a sugar and it being a substrate for sucrase makes sense. Does that make sense to you guys? It's not always that helpful, but you know, sometimes it is. Okay, back to erythrulose. It's a ketose, and how many carbons does it have, folks?
Four.
It has four. So what's that called if we are classifying the sugar by chain length? Tetrose. Yep. And where did I get that? Right here. The four carbon sugar is called a tetrose. Okay, so if we were to put those two things together, what might you call it? Yep, a keto tetrose. Is that okay for everybody? Okay, so if we were to exchange the descriptors, we would call that a what? Tetraketose. Yes. Not too bad, right, folks? Okay, all right. Want a million of these questions on the final exam? Okay, all right. All right. Acetoheptulose. Ah. Okay, well, first of all, I'm sure we can do the functional group on this one. It's a what? Yeah, it's a ketose. Anyone having trouble seeing the ketone? Anyone who pointed out? We're all good with that. Okay, good, good. How many carbons does this one have?
Seven.
It has seven. And seven was not on this list here. We just got up to hex. Does anyone remember what the Greek prefix is that we use for seven? Het. Yeah, so we all want to use sept, right? But it's not, it's het. So this one is a heptose. We kind of got a little clue right there, right? So if we were to put that together, chain link and functional group sugar, what would we call that, folks? Keto heptose. Yep. Or what? Heptoketose. Perfect. Okay, you liking the carbohydrate chapter so far? Oh, yes. Questions for me, folks? We're good? Okay, anyone still writing? Okay, no problem. It's like the end of the semester. No problem. You're still writing, right? You're still writing 40 minutes later, right? Okay, all right. We'll pick this up next time. Just kidding, because this is on video. Okay, for real though, is anyone still writing?
No.
Okay. Okay, I just wanted to do a quick review of Fisher projections, just because this chapter uses a whole lot of Fisher projections. So we kind of sort of did this in a couple of other chapters, and I said, well, do it a whole lot in the carbohydrate chapter. I just need you to kind of visualize this right now. Well, here's where we're going to use it a whole lot. So yes, you have seen these slides before, folks. This is a review. I just want to show it to you again so we can remind ourselves of what we're doing here. So let's see, which one do we have here? We have green going fast. Okay. So our Fisher projections, these are trying to represent something in 3D on a 2D surface. So what we do is take something like this, a molecule. And so we have the blue ball coming at you guys and the green one going back. So we have the wedge and we have the dash. Is everybody okay with wedges coming out at you, dashes back? Okay. And then anything that has the plain old bond lines, that's in the plane of the board, like this, okay, just to remind you. And since carbon's always black, we're going to have the W be the yellow color right here, okay? So what we're going to do is we're going to squish this. So if we do this, then it ends up looking like that and that right there. And this right here, we don't have to draw the carbon in there because why? Does anyone remember? It's bonded to four different groups, which is called what? Do you guys remember? It's a chiral carbon, yes. It's also called an asymmetric carbon or a chirality center or a chiral center. Does that sound familiar? Kind of, sort of? Okay. So that's what it looks like. Now, remember that anything that's horizontal, these bonds right here, they're supposed to be coming out at you. Okay, so these ones are coming out at you, so we could have drawn those with wedges. And anything that's going up or down, so vertical, is going back into the board. Are we okay with that, folks? Okay. So what we typically do when we draw sugars is we draw the most oxidized carbon towards the top. And for us, that means the carbon that has the most carbon-oxygen connections. So you'll see the carbonyl group from the aldehyde and the ketone drawn at the top. So that's the C double bond O, because that's the most oxidized carbon, the one with the most carbon-oxygen connections. Okay, so that was that slide. And the next one should look pretty familiar to you folks too. And we just talked about bonds coming out and bonds going back. And that is this little bit of information right here. And this is when I started to talk about R and S configurations when we were talking about chiral centers. And we said that if you guys took organic chemistry, Chem 12A and 12B, that you would have to learn how to identify R and S, but for us, what we just needed to know was if you were given one molecule and it was labeled as R, the mirror image would be what?
Mm-hmm.
S. And if you were given a molecule that was labeled as S, the mirror image would be what? R. But is everyone okay remembering that we did that? Okay, great. So again, this is just some of the same stuff. And manipulating Fisher projections. So when we see a Fisher projection, we can turn it 180 degrees in the plane of the board or the paper, and it's gonna be the same thing. And I wanna show you that with the model. So let me get the blue down and the green back. So the red is the OH, and the H will be the yellow one because the carbon's always black, okay? So you see here how we just switched it upside down like that. Now I'm not gonna break any of these bonds right here. I'm just gonna move the molecule around and you'll see that it's the same thing. So we can go ahead and take the OH coming out at you here, and the H is right here coming out at you, and see that the blue ball is now at the top and the green one is at the bottom, and those are going back.
And if you don't break any bonds and remake them, you just turn the molecule a certain way, and it's the same thing. It's the same molecule. So do you guys see how if you turn it upside down, you still got the same thing with the Fisher projections? Are we okay with that? All right, good though. So what you cannot do with your drawing is you cannot just turn it 90 degrees. So again, I'm going to show you guys with the molecule so you can see what we're talking about. Because if I just showed it to you on paper, you'd be like, okay, I'll just believe you. We're going to move on. So let's do this again. We've got the hydrogen again in yellow because folks, the carbon's always black. And so are we okay with this lining up like this?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now, if we turned this 90 degrees like that, and we drew it like that, and we said, oh, it's the same molecule, well, then I would not be allowed to break any of these bonds. I would have to just move it around and have it line up. But if I try to do that, what you guys will see is that the hydrogen and the OH don't line up. So I line up the blue and the green, but the yellow, which again is hydrogen, and the OH right there, which is the red, those aren't lining up. But if I do the mirror image, remember our enantiomers?
Mm-hmm.
How they're mirror images of each other, but you could not move them around and superimpose them
mm-hmm.
and get them to be the same. You would have to break one bond and remake the bond. Now I don't know which one. Anyways, okay. Hopefully I grabbed the right one. Okay, so now we can see that it lines up. So the OH and the H and the green and the blue, this one was the enantiomer, the mirror image of that one right there. Are we okay with that, folks? Okay, so you can turn your Fisher projection upside down to do 180 rotations. But you can't do a 90 degree rotation because that represents the enantiomer. That's just how it works out. We take the models and we take a look at it. Does that make sense for us? Okay, so a Fisher projection also may not be lifted from the plane of the paper and turned over, like that, because you just drew the what? You just drew the enantiomer. And remember, I know when we're looking at, is this a mirror image of this, the top and the bottom, it's like, that's not the mirror image, because in our brains, we want the whole thing to be the mirror image, right, friends?
Mm-hmm.
But you can see at the chiral carbons, they've drawn it mirror image. You guys see that?
Mm-hmm.
If you need to, flip this way and this that way, and then it'll be like, oh, okay, they're mirror images, so they're enantiomers. So they're not exactly the same. Because remember, enantiomers, they were isomers that had the same atom connectivity, so the same connection of atoms, but somehow they were different. They were different spatially. And then we talked about drug design and how the different enantiomers will have different effects in our body. Do y'all remember that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So this does matter. It's not just some kind of esoteric thing. It really, really does matter for biology and physiology and how things are functioning in our body. So you can't just take your Fisher projection and flip it over like that. Which sounds really strange because number one was you can take something and rotate it 180 degrees. So it's kind of like, what? Number four says you can hold a Fisher projection steady and at one point. So let me line this one back up. I think I'm still holding the enantiomer. Yep. Okay, so if you hold one thing, like say the green ball back there, and we rotate this around, you can draw it however you want as long as the green one is held steady.
Mm-hmm.
And why that works is because there's free rotation around this single bond here. so you can draw it any way. As long as you're not breaking bonds and remaking and rearranging things and remaking the bonds.
Okie dokie, Smokies?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So you won't have to do a whole lot of this, but if you were to take Chem 12, you'd be doing a lot of this.
So if you interchange any of your two groups at your chirocarbon, so let me just remind you guys that this is called your chirocarbon, and that's the carbon that we don't draw in, we just have it at the cross point right there. You're going to change the configuration of the molecule. We will go R to S or S to R. So see how we changed that to that? We just flipped it. We made it go from R to S. And that's because we broke bonds and we rearranged things and we remade bonds. Okie dokie, Smokies? Okay. All right, meso compounds. Don't worry about meso compounds. Sounds like a soup, right? Don't worry about meso compounds. If we have more time in class, we might go over what meso compounds are, but it's the end of the semester, okay? Now, we have talked about this slide two times so far, and this one was, we were just reviewing what this actually looks like in space. And again, I don't mean outer space, folks. I just mean space. Okay. So this right here, you don't get sugars that are flat like this. They're like, hello, I'm a glucose. They actually, you know, like have shape, okay? And just to remind you, folks, we draw the most oxidized carbon at the top. So you got your aldehyde or your ketone oriented towards the top. And anything that's a vertical bond means it's going back, okay? So I'll start right here at this chiral carbon. So what we have is we have this guy, which is right here, going back, and the rest of the molecule down here going back, and we have the OH and the H, and then if we go to the next one, then we'll flip that forward like that, mm-hmm. And this part of the molecule is going back. And this part of the molecule is going back, and we're kind of ignoring it right now. And we have OH, which is right there, and H that's there. And if we go to the next one, we have hydrogen and OH coming out at you, because remember, if you're horizontal, it's coming out. And then those two bonds going back, so it's just the rest of the molecule. On to the next one, which is right here. Okay, so we've got OH and H. There. This part of the molecule is back here. It's going back, and then this one is going back also. And then this carbon is drawn in because it's not a chiral carbon. So it's connected to two hydrogens, two of the same thing. So do you guys remember how we classify a chiral and achiral? Okay, so the chiral carbons, you had to be bonded to four different groups. And you have two hydrogens here, so they're the same. So that's just convention that we draw in those carbons. And you can see that right here, the two hydrogens, and then the OH up there. And this one also, that's carbon double bond H. So if you forgot the shorthand for that up there, somebody smells really good. Whoever that is, I really am liking that scent. Every time I come back to my desk, I'm like, oh, that makes me happy. This right here is the aldehyde like that, okay? Does that make sense, folks? We've seen that a few times before, but I know we've seen a whole lot of things a whole lot of times before, and sometimes it, you know, gets jumbled towards the end of the semester, right? Yes, okay. So that's why we draw that in, because when we have a double bond, we consider it to be bonded to the same thing twice, and then so it's not chiral. Okie dokie, Smokies?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so is everybody okay on this now? Remember that we went over it before?
Okay, if you don't remember it in depth, you remember that we at least saw this before? Okay, good. Okay, so
So a little bit of a reminder on enantiomers and diastereomers. So remember that we have isomers. We have isomers, and these are molecules that have the same what? Those are constitutional isomers, so yes, you're almost there, but that's my next thought. They have the same what? Molecular what? Yes, molecular formula. Okay, so glucose is C6H12O6. So notice we have D-glucose and L-glucose here. So if L-glucose is C6H12O6, and D-glucose is probably the same, right, friends? What about the lactose? Is it C6? Is that a 6 carbon? Yeah, it does. C6 and H12O6? At least the yes on the O's? Okay. Yes, it is. So these are all isomers of each other. And then remember, with isomers, what we have is constitutional isomers. And we have stereoisomers. Does that sound familiar, folks?
Mm-hmm.
And then in stereoisomers, we have enantiomers and diastereomers. Okay, so constitutional isomers, folks. The constitutional isomers were the molecules that had the same molecular formula, but you had a different connection of atoms. So say maybe you had 2-fluorohexane versus 3-fluorohexane, where you had the same molecular formula, but in one molecule the fluorine is connected to the second carbon, and in the other molecule the fluorine is connected to the third carbon. Does that sound familiar? So that's not what we're talking about here. So we're not talking about the constitutional isomers. We're talking about molecules that have the same molecular formula, but they also have the same connection of atoms, right? And then those are called stereoisomers. And if those two molecules are mirror images of each other, they were called enantiomers. And if they're not mirror images of each other, they were called diastereomers. Does that sound familiar? Okay. Now, D and L glucose, those are enantiomers of each other, okay? So they have the same molecular formula, same atom connectivity, so we're into stereoisomer land. And then they are mirror images of each other, so they're enantiomers. So if we put D and L glucose next to each other in the regular Fischer projection, where they're 2D and they're flat, like this, we could draw them so they're mirror images. They're not drawn in that fashion, but what you can see is that wherever D-glucose has an R orientation for its chiral carbon, the L-glucose will have a what? An S, the exact opposite orientation. So we have R, S, R, S, S, R, R, S. So the enantiomers, they have to have exactly the opposite at each point. Does that ring a bell? We did talk about that. Okay. So D-galactose, why that's not an enantiomer? Well, it is C6H12O6, and we do have the same atom connectivity. We start with an aldehyde at the end, and then we have a carbon that is connected to a carbonyl carbon. And it's connected to an OH, and it's connected to another carbon that's connected to an OH, and on and on and on, it's the same. But if you look at D-glucose versus D-galactose, what you'll notice is that at this chiral carbon, you have R here, and if this is an enantiomer, this should be what? S, but it's not, okay? And if you have R there, S there, okay, well, that one works, but
the next one, you have S and you have R. Okay, that one works too, but that one you have R and R here. So you have 2 points where it's not working. So what's that if it's not an enantiomer? Well, then it just falls into the other pile, which is diastereomer. Okie dokie smokies? Okay, so for the enantiomers, you have to have the opposite every single chirality point. Questions for me?
You thought you were done with diastereomers, didn't you?
Mm-hmm.
Aww.
Okay, so the number of chiral carbons, also called asymmetric centers. Is gonna determine the number of stereoisomers in a series. What on earth does that mean? Well, good thing I've come with slides to tell you, right? To show you. Okay, so how many stereoisomers do we have in an allodohexose series? Well, okay. Your number of stereoisomers is going to be 2 to the nth power. And what is N? N is the number of chiral centers or chiral carbons, okay? So if we have 4 chiral carbons, we would have 4 enantiomeric sets, which is 16 stereoisomers total. What on earth am I talking about? Well, let me show you with a tiniest bit of math, I promise, okay? All right. So, looking at this molecule right here, folks, how many chiral carbons? It's the same as all of the ones pictured on the bottom. How many? 4. So we have one here, and one here. The ones on the end are not chiral because that aldehyde, that carbonyl-carbon, is double bonded to the O. So this right here, the other way we could draw it is okay, so that's not chiral. And then this one down here is bonded to 2 hydrogens. That's 2 of the same. You see that?
Mm-hmm.
Also, on the bottom, wherever you have a cross point where you have not drawn in a carbon, that's telling you this is a chiral carbon. That's the point of those Fischer projections, is so it can just tell you where the chiral carbons are, so you don't have to, like, oh my gosh, go through, do I know how to do this or not, okay? So, if we have 4 chiral centers, or we have 4 chiral carbons, N is what number here for this series? 4. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And 2 to the 4th power is 2 times 2 times 2 times 2. Do you guys remember that kind of sort of maybe?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And it doesn't get any harder than that, folks. I promise I won't make you do calculus. And that's going to be how many?
16.
Yes, it's right there. That's 16. So 2 times 2 is 4, times 2 is 8, times 2 is 16. Are you guys okay with that?
Mm-hmm.
All right. So all of the D sugars in this series, there's 8 of them, are down here. Those are all the stereoisomers that are D sugars. Now, what's the difference between a D and L sugar? Don't worry, we'll get there. Now, what is not pictured are the other 8, which are the L sugars, which are just the mirror images of every single one of those there. So D allose would have a mirror image called what? L allose, okay? And D altrose would have a mirror image called what?
L altrose.
Yeah, so just the mirror images of all of those. Does that make sense to us?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so what on earth is D and what is L? Well, it's a little convoluted, which you should expect because this is chemistry, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, all right, so along came glyceraldehyde. Glyceraldehyde is drawn there for
this
you
carbons does glyceraldehyde have, folks? Just one. And then you guys see how wonderful the Fisher projections are at telling you how many chirocarbons there are? At the cross point, where the carbon is not drawn, that one is chiral, okay? Just in case you weren't paying attention, thinking about your date on Friday night, there's the chirocarbon right there and right there. Now, D-glyceraldehyde, this is dextrorotatory, meaning that it rotates the plane polarized light that's incoming to the right, to a certain angle to the right. Now, if we take a sample of L-glyceraldehyde and we put it in the tube, it would rotate plane polarized light which direction? Opposite, to the left, is level rotatory. Are we okay with this, folks? Okay, so what I want you to notice about D-glyceraldehyde is that the chiral carbon, the one that's close to the CH2 right there, for D, we have the OH on the right. And in a Fisher projection, L-glyceraldehyde has the OH to the left. Are you guys okay with that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now it's always going to be the bottommost chiral carbon, not the bottommost carbon, but the bottommost chiral carbon is going to have the OH drawn to the right for the D sugars, and all of our L sugars will have the bottommost chiral carbon with the OH drawn to the left. Now, that doesn't always match up with dextrorotatory and level rotatory. I'm sorry about that. It matches up with the glyceraldehyde because this is where we got the D and L system. So, moving on to the next slide, it's going to tell you that almost all of your naturally occurring monosaccharides have the same R stereochemical configuration as D-glyceraldehyde at the chiral center furthest from the carbonyl group, so the one, the bottommost chiral carbon. Okay, so what that is saying is that naturally occurring sugars tend to be D. Alright? Naturally occurring sugars do not tend to be L. We can make those in the lab, and we often do, but the naturally occurring sugars are D. Now, with our amino acids, that tends to be the opposite. The naturally occurring ones tend to be the L's. But we're not in that chapter, so let's go back to this one, okay? So again, folks, when you have the bottommost chiral carbon with an OH drawn to the right, that is your D sugar. And when you have your bottommost chiral carbon with the OH on it drawn to the left, that's your which sugar? That's your L. Okie-dokie, smokies. So notice for the D and L designation that we ignored the stuff that was up here. You guys see that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so we're concentrating on the bottommost chiral carbon and whether that OH is drawn to the left or the right. Do we think we could identify D and L sugars on an exam? It's just like this. I would give you this with no name right there. Or I just say this is a glucose. Is it D or L? Could you guys do that for me?
Yes.
Awesome. Okay, because there will be those questions.
And you'll be like, I got this one. Yes!
Okay, so remember how I said there's something that doesn't match up because it does for glyceraldehyde, but not all the D and L's. So this is, again, written for you guys at the top of this slide. It says the D and L notation have no relation to the direction in which a given sugar rotates plane polarized light except for their glyceraldehyde. So glyceraldehyde, folks, the D is dextrorotatory, the L is levorotatory. But with our other sugars, D doesn't always mean it's dextrorotatory and L doesn't always mean it's levorotatory. It is just D and L like this that match up for glyceraldehyde. But your bottommost hydrocarbon on your sugars, if the OH is drawn to the right on a Fischer projection, it's a what? It's a D. If you're on your bottommost hydrocarbon, if the OH that's stuck on that guy is drawn to the left, it's a what? L. Yes, okay. So notice right here, let me pick one out. D-glulose. That's a funny name, huh? Gulose. Right there, that is a D sugar because our bottommost hydrocarbon has the OH drawn to the right. But that sugar is not dextrorotatory, meaning if you put it in the little sample tube and plain polarized light is coming at it, D-gulose does not rotate the plain polarized light to the right. It's not dextrorotatory, it's levorotatory, and how you would know that is you'd see the minus sign right there. So it's rotating plane polarized light to the left, okay? Does that make sense, folks? So it matches up with glyceraldehyde, but not with everything else. Okay, any questions, folks? Okay. So the D sugars, some of them are dextrorotatory, some of them are levorotatory. But we always draw the OH on the right on the bottommost carbon for our D sugars. Okay, epimers! Epimers are diastereomers, and they only differ in their configuration at one chiral carbon. So if we look at ribose and arabinose, we can see that they both have how many chiral carbons, folks?
Three.
Can we pick that off of the Fischer projection if I give you a picture and I say how many chiral carbons are here? Mm-hmm. And say I gave you this right here. Could you guys just tell me three? Mm-hmm. Okay, all right, good, good. Now notice how at this carbon and this carbon right here, at those two points, we have the same configuration. Mm-hmm. But at this one, it's opposite. So that's what epimers are. You've got one chiral carbon that has opposite orientation of that O and the H, and the others are the same, exactly the same. That's it. Those are epimers. Okie dokie, smokies.
So it's just one that's opposite, not all.
Yeah.
Just one.
Yeah. Yeah. So can you see what kind of questions are incoming to you on the final exam, folks?
Yes. Seems a little easier.
Oh, just me. You need to, like, knock on wood because the rest of the chapter you will.
Maybe you could just put more.
Do you remember heavy acetals and acetals? Yes, those are coming for you on Wednesday again. Okay, so let's classify our sugars as D or L, folks. So 1A, what do we have there? Bottommost chiral carbon has that OH to the left. So that sugar is a D or an L?
L.
That one is an L. So this is the part of the final exam where you guys are like, I'm nailing it, yeah, right? Okay, the next sugar over, we look at the bottommost chiral carbon and we go, oh, that sugar is a what? A D. Are we okay with this?
Mm-hmm.
Yay! Okay, and then 1C, D or L?
D.
D. Good. Anyone have problems with those? We're all okay? Good, good. Okay, number two, which of the following sugars are epimers? And we want to circle the epimeric carbons, which just means the carbon that made them be epimers, okay? So we can call this 1, 2, and 3 if we don't want to say glucose, mannose, and gulose. Although gulose is fun to say, right?
Gulose. All right, so we just want to look for a couple where they're quite similar and then just make sure they're opposite at one point. What about one and two? Those look good? Okay, so you kind of have to switch gears here because we're used to looking for mirror images to look for enantiomers, right, friends? But here we're looking for ones that are very similar, they're just opposite at one point. So if they look at one and two, same, 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 yeah, yeah. And then what about right here? They're opposite. So are these epimers? Yes, because same, 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 and then opposite. Do you guys see that? Anyone having trouble seeing it? Anybody go over it again? Okay. So these two right here, epimers, and if we were to circle the epimeric carbon, you could do it this way or you can just put a circle like that. Either way would be good, okay? I suppose you guys are doing it online so you won't be writing a circle around it, but yeah, if you were doing it on paper, either way. Do we see the point where it makes an epimer, folks? Okay, so what about that third one there? Third one's just like, I didn't get picked for the team, right? Okay. Alrighty. Number three, how many aldopentoses are there? How many are D, how many are L? Okay. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. No, we drew hexoses in number two. So aldopentoses. So we've got an aldehyde. Aldehyde is always on the end, right, folks? So we've got an aldehyde on the end, and then with our sugars, we usually have this a chiral carbon at the end. Are we okay with that? Okay. So this is just what we've been seeing over and over again, so I just set it up like this. Okay, aldopentose. So I took care of the aldo portion of it, right, folks? Okay. Pent means it has how many carbons? Five. And I already drew how many in? Two. And so the ones in the center are going to be our chiral ones. Are we all right with that? Now, it doesn't really matter which way you draw the OHs and the H, because I'm just drawing this right here to kind of like thought process on the paper so I could see what I'm working with. Because I needed to know how many chiral carbons I is how many? Three. So N equals three. Are we okay with this, folks? And where on earth did I get this? It was back here on this slide. We did it. Okay. We said you have 2 to the nth, and N was the number of chiral centers. So we have 2 to the 3rd power, and that gives us what? 8. And if you don't know how to do 2 to the 3rd power, it's just 2 times 2 times 2, which is 8. Are you guys okay with that? Now here's the thing, 4 of them are going to be D, and 4 of them are going to be L. If you have a D sugar, the mirror image of it is the what? Is the L. So if you have 4 D's, then you're going to have 4 L's. If we had 5 D sugars, you'd have how many L sugars? 5, good. I mean, does this make sense to us? Okay, so can we do that on the test? Okay, so here we are with our cyclic structures of the monosaccharides, and this is where we're going to recall our hemiacetals and our acetals, just like you guys were asking for, right? But this is a gigondo thing to tackle, one that I don't want to do with our last 10 minutes, and this is where we're going to learn how to draw Hayward structures or Hayward projections from our Fisher projections. So what we're going to do, folks, is we're going to take a Fisher projection and lay it on its side and curl it up
see that that is a very large chunk of stuff to do. Okay, so we will start with that on Wednesday. And unless my son tells me my promotion is right exactly at lecture time, in that case, I will have it ready and waiting for you. And for those of you guys who didn't hear me say, for the lipid, the eicosanoid section, I think there were like 6 or 7 slides that I said we'd get to, but I had to go to my uncle's funeral. So if I do not get that little lecture for you guys uploaded soon, I'll just take that part off of the test for Wednesday. Okie dokie, Smokies. Okay, does anyone have any questions for me? Okay, if you